Good morning. Thank you for joining us this morning as we come together to just worship God, to get into His Word, and to learn how to live our faith. As we're still in the book of James with lessons on living our faith, let me encourage you to know, number one, is we're together. No matter where you are, we're together because God is there with us, and He makes us one. Let me encourage you, if you're not able to come to church, let me encourage you now that as we encourage one another toward loving good deeds, let me encourage you now. And if you're just in separate buildings here on campus, just know that we're still one in Him. I just love coming together on Sunday morning. It's what makes us one, and it encourages us and sets us up to live our faith in this world. Just be blessed. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time together. May you be blessed. May you change us. And Father, may you fill us. And may we honor you in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Have a great service.
There is no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved, He's proven Himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. There is no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved, He's proven Himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. There is no rock, there is no God like our God. No other name worthy of all our praise. The rock of salvation that cannot be moved, He's proven Himself to be faithful and true. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Jesus is the rock, rock of ages. Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like ours.
Psalm 18:2 says, "The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold."
Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. Rock of ages, Jesus is the rock. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. There is no rock, there is no God like ours. to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near. Praise Him in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord who o'er all things so wondrously reigneth. Shelters the under His wings, yea, so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how thy desires all have been granted in what He ordained? Praise to the Lord who doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely His goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do if with His love He befriend thee. Praise to the Lord, O let all that is in me adore Him. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before Him. Let the amen sound from His people again, gladly for all we adore Him. All your ways are good, all your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. And I will trust in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go, where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move, I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love, how you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah. Not unto the world, not unto my life, I will live for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find all I need in you alone, in you alone. Where you go, I'll go, where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move, I will follow you. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I follow you. Everlasting in you, there's freedom for my soul. In you, there's joy, unending joy. And I will follow
where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Who you love, I'll love. How you serve, I'll serve. If this life I'll lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah. And where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Do you love, I'll love. If this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah,
I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken, I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be? My King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you. In all I do, I honor you. I'm forgiven. Because you were forsaken, I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be? My King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. And it's my joy to honor you. In all I do, I honor you. In all I do, I honor you. Amazing love, amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I honor you in all I do. I honor you.
You know, this year we've been focusing on living our faith. And lately we've been in the book of James, where James shows us how, gives us lessons on living our faith. Now today we're going to be looking at James 4, 4 through 7. And here James gives us a warning that will affect how the world sees us living our faith. Let's look at our passage this morning. It's James 4, 4 through 7. It says, "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world will become an enemy of God. Or do you think that Scripture says without reason that the Spirit He caused to live in us envies intensely? But He gives us more grace. That is why the Scripture says God opposes the proud but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you." You know, people commit adultery in various ways in our world, and our world is pretty notorious for that, actually. Commitment to one person for a lifetime does not seem to be as expected as it might have been in the past. And I can't tell you how many people have been surprised when they find out Jean and I have been married for 37 years. Not only does she look incredibly young, but I probably look very old. But when it comes to that, they're very pleased. 37 years is amazing, and it seems like it just begun. Now, I've had too many conversations throughout my ministry about infidelity, situations of adultery by one or both spouses. And it's true that relationships are hard and require a lot of work. In fact, it's easy to get so busy and so distracted enough that the enemy can bring another person into the picture. Couples have to work on their relationships, and let's be honest, it's hard work. But when you reap great benefits when you make great investments. And when you invest in your relationship, the relationship is amazing. Marriage is an investment. Now, it surprised me how many times I've heard as part of the reason that someone has strayed that, you know, God wants me to be happy and I'm more happy with this other woman or this other man. Well, there's no passage in the Bible that says God wants you to be happy. Now, He loves us and He provides for us, but happiness is a fickle emotion. God wants us to be obedient because He knows what's best for us, and He tells us. There are several passages that tell us that God wants us to be obedient. Jesus said this in John 14, 15, "If you love me, you will obey my commands." Obedience to God's commands or directions are found in His Word. It is in Scripture, James 1, 15. "But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does." God's intention from creation was for man and woman to be made one and stay together. In the Ten Commandments in Exodus 20, 14, it says, "You shall not commit adultery." But there's another type of adultery that takes place even more often than that between a man and a woman. And it's spiritual adultery. When Christians are supposed to be married to Christ spiritually, we are the bride of Christ. So when we stray, when we go after things of this world, when we go after idols, we cheat on Him. And this is something that we don't like to own up to, but it happens all the time. Bob Stacy wrote, "Adulterers, not a pretty word, not a word most of us would want applied to us. And yet it is a word that James applied to Christians who are friends of the world. The church is the bride of Christ, and as such, she is to be loyal and true to Him, pure and holy in His sight. Could James have made it any plainer? Do you prove your faithfulness to God by your daily life, or do you prove your faithful friendship with the world? I fear that many Christians spend more time with their mistress, the world, than they do with Christ. They spend more money on their mistress, the world, than they do on Christ. And they are more at home with their mistress than they are with Christ. And what could be sadder than that?" So what is spiritual adultery? What does it mean? Well, in our passage we see several things. Spiritual adultery means friendship with the world. Spiritual adultery means opposition to God. And spiritual adultery means giving into the devil. Now let's look at this first one. Spiritual adultery means friendship with the world. Look at verse 4 again. "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God?" Little boy goes up and asks his mother, "Mom, can I go over and play with Timmy?" And his mother says, "You don't even like Timmy." He says, "Okay, all right, then can I go over and fight with him?" You know, what's wrong with being friends or having friends? Well, it depends on your friends. Jesus was a friend of sinners. And why did he do that? Well, because God wants all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the fullness of truth. And because Jesus came not to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance. Jesus could associate with sinners in order to give them life, but he didn't allow them to influence him. He could go to a wedding without getting drunk. He could be alone with a woman who had had five husbands and was living with another man and not be inclined to lust after her. There is absolutely nothing wrong with associating with people who are not Christians. In fact, there's no way to be a witness if you don't. But we cannot allow the worldly actions of those who do not know Christ bring us down. The idea for us is to present a witness to them. However, some Christians may find themselves being influenced by those in the world and do things they would not normally do. 1 Corinthians 15:33, do not be misled. Bad company corrupts good character. You know, throughout my life, I've had a lot of good non-Christian friends. You know, and as far as their friendship was good. You know, some I would go fishing with, some I would go watch Nebraska games with. I was also even on a men's softball team that was sponsored by Wilson's Pub. Now, we weren't very good, but we had a lot of fun playing softball. Now, most of the friends I've had since grade school, and although they knew that I didn't drink in high school, they always invited me to the parties, and I kind of watched out for them, and they kind of watched out for me. Now, my oldest friend, the one I've had since kindergarten, was one of those guys who drank a good bit and partied a good bit. But I was always there, and he was, and while he was still coherent, he was a lot of fun. Now, although I left Omaha to work, and we all kind of stayed in touch. It was neat. And my relationship with my oldest friend worked out fine, because today he's not only a Christian, but he became a Presbyterian minister. And we've talked, and it's just so awesome. But see, not all relationships turn out that well. In fact, sometimes the reverse is true. See, some people influence others to leave their church, and it may be a gradual thing, but it happens. I knew of a young couple, and they were a sweet young couple, and they started to run with the wrong crowd. And they started frequenting bars and going out at night. And somehow or another, the wife ended up having an affair with one of the men in the bar, and she left her husband. And it was sad because they had two little, sweet young girls. And that's an example of how the wrong crowd can bring people to lose their witness. And it was really sad. Having non-Christian friends is not a bad thing. It isn't. But if we get too involved with the things of this world, even if the things seem to be okay, then they can cause us to commit spiritual adultery. It says anything in this world that comes between you and your relationship to the Lord and keeps you from worshiping or serving or giving is a matter of spiritual adultery. Look at verse 4. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? And we have to be careful about friendship with the world. Now, spiritual adultery also means opposition to God. Look at that verse 4 again. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. Or do you think Scripture says without reason that the Spirit he caused to live in us envies intensely? But he gives us more grace. That is why the Scripture says God opposes the proud and gives grace to humble. So a little boy talking to his father, and he got in trouble, so his father sent him to bed early. And about 5 minutes after he sent him to bed, he says, Dad! His father said, What? And the little boy said, I'm thirsty, can you bring me a glass of water? And the father said, No, you had your chance, lights out. 5 minutes later, Dad, I'm thirsty, can I have a glass of water? He says, I told you no, and I asked, and listen, if you ask again, I'm going to come in here and spank you. About 5 minutes later, Dad, and the father said, What? When you come in and spank me, can you bring me a glass of water? Guys, when we were small children, who did you fear most, your father or your mother? You know, fear has a place in our lives, whether we like it or not. In fact, if we don't learn to fear some people or certain things, we could easily find ourselves in trouble and maybe in a lot of trouble. If a person doesn't fear or have respect for authority, they could have all kinds of troubles. A lack of fear for teachers could land you in the principal's office or maybe even booted out of school. A lack of fear for the law could land you in jail. Now, I've told the story before of the old train trestle by my house. It was about four blocks from my house, and it crossed over a pretty busy street, and a lot of my friends would just walk across the trestle then try to cross the street. Now, the freight line was still active, and you could see about 3 or 4 miles in either direction, but my dad told me never cross that trestle. And boy, I didn't. I knew the minute I crossed that trestle, my father, who seemed to know everybody in that section of town, would find out I crossed that trestle, and then I would be in trouble. It was interesting later when I got older. He says, "Yeah, I'm going to go cross the trestle. It's my decision." Well, by that time, they'd taken the trestle out. And I'm glad I never went across it. But there's something worse than, you know, making your mom and dad angry or mad. It's making your heavenly Father mad and angry. Job 4, 8 and 9. "As I have observed, those who plow evil and those who sow trouble reap it. At the breath of God, they are destroyed. At the blast of his anger, they perish." Because we don't want to make God mad. Psalm 7, 6. "Arise, O Lord, in your anger. Rise up against the rage of my enemies. Awake, my God. Decree justice." Our Father is strong and he's righteous. And sometimes we look at God as just a friend and he doesn't matter. Because he is our God and he's a God of justice. Psalm 27, 9 says this, "Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, O God, my Savior." That was written from a heart that was broken, who knew they displeased God and cried out for him not to leave. Psalm 30, verse 5, "For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may remain for a night, but rejoicing comes in the morning." That is a beautiful promise, and that is the God we serve. Psalm 38, 1 through 3, "O Lord, do not rebuke me in your anger or discipline me in your wrath, for your arrows have pierced me, and your hand has come down upon me. Because your wrath, there is no health in my body. My bones have no soundness because of my sin." We do not want to be in a bad relationship with God. We do not want to make him angry because we don't want him to be our enemy. Remember, James 4, 4, "You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world is hatred toward God? Anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God." Apparently, we can get so absorbed with the things of the world that we can actually become an enemy of God. And I don't believe I want that to happen in my life. This tells me that we must not get too involved with the things of this world. Now, does that mean we can't go on trips? No. Does that mean we can't go shopping? No. Does that mean we can't go see a movie or a ball game? No. Does that mean we can't buy something new? No. Does it mean we can't even eat out? No. But it does mean that we need to be careful on how much we tie ourselves into the world. If we get to the point where all we want to do is live for pleasure and fun and going and doing and acquiring more and more material things, then we could well meet with the anger of God. God wants, demands, and desires our devotion to him. God wants, demands, and desires our devotion to him, and he deserves it. He gives us life, breath, every good and perfect gift that we have, and he alone gives us the promise of eternal life. Don't you think that qualifies him for more devotion than the things of this world? You know, spiritual adultery also means giving in to the devil. Look at verse 7. "Submit yourself then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you." I read this week a story. It was Sunday morning and everyone in Jonestown wakes up early and they go to church. Well, they were all in church and before the service starts, the townspeople sit and they talk in the pews and talk about their lives and their families. When suddenly at the altar, Satan appears and everyone starts screaming and running to the front and getting out of there, and everybody scrambles and gets out until everybody's gone. And then there's one man who's sitting calmly in the pew in the middle of the church. And he seemed to be oblivious of the fact that God's enemy is right there in the building. In fact, this even puzzled Satan. So he went up and says, "Hey, don't you know who I am?" And the man said, "Yep, sure do." Well, "Well, aren't you afraid of me?" Satan asked him. He says, "Nope, sure ain't." Satan was perturbed, and he says, "Well, and why aren't you afraid of me?" And the man says, "Well, I've been married to your sister for 25 years. Okay, Satan doesn't have a sister. And he does, but he does have a lot of people that follow him, and most of them probably don't even know they are following him. Ephesians 2, 1 through 3 says this, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath." C.S. Lewis was once asked about whether he believed in the devil. And he wrote this. He says, "There is no uncreated being except God. God has no opposite. Now, the proper question is whether I believe in devils, and I do. That is to say, I believe in angels, and I believe that some of those, by abuse of their free will, have become enemies of God. Satan, the leader or dictator of devils, is the opposite, not of God, but of Michael." I think Lewis is correct. Even though Satan or the devil is powerful, he is not all powerful. Only God is all powerful. He is the only uncreated being there is. The devil, however, is a created being and apparently originally created as a good angel. In fact, you can see that in Ezekiel. Until his arrogant pride got the best of him and he got booted out of heaven. And what will happen to the devil? Well, Revelation 20:10 says this, "And the devil who deceived them was thrown into the lake of burning sulfur where the beast and the false prophet had been thrown. And they will be tormented day and night forever and ever." Guys, it sounds like the devil is not the someone you want to keep company with. And we do keep company with him when we get too involved with the things of this world. That's exactly what it says in Ephesians. Instead of running with the devil, we need to resist him. And the only way I know to resist the devil is to submit to God. We seek his face, do his will, obey his word, and in this way we will resist the evil one. Adultery is a bad thing. It breaks up families and hurts everyone involved. But spiritual adultery can be even far worse. Because spiritual adultery makes us enemies of God. The only cure I know for adultery, and spiritual adultery actually, or any sin for that matter, is to humble ourselves before the Lord. And it says when we humble ourselves, he will lift us up. We humble ourselves because he knows what's best for us. He's made the rule book, and he created us. And he knows those things, and the Ten Commandments hurts us. The pan is hot, don't touch it. And if you look at the Ten Commandments again, you could look at the first four are basically on our relationship with God. And when we don't have that relationship, it's called adultery. Because we love the world more than our Creator. Guys, when we humble ourselves, he will lift us up out of our sin and into his loving arms and the mercy and grace he gives us. See, that is the only way we can truly live our faith and show the world who Jesus is. Let's do that. Let's live our faith. Let's seek God, submit ourselves, humble ourselves, and know that he loves us. And the things he calls us to do is the best things for us. And when we live that way, we live differently. And when people see us live our faith, they will ask us why. And we get to tell them about Jesus. That's what we're called to do.
Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns His face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sins upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear on my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was a
today's communion meditation, I would like to offer or share with you the guiding principle that guides everything that happens in and around my classroom. This concept is simply known as We Is Greater Than Me. Well, what is We Is Greater Than Me? Let me describe it to you how I describe it to my students. Imagine that we have three different stones. They're all about the same size. And we're going to take the first stone and we're going to toss it into a pond. What happens? Did you see the ripples that radiated out from where the stone splashed? It goes all the way across the pond, right? Okay. Now we're going to go on a little bit of a field trip. We're going to take that second stone. We're going to go to a bigger body of water. Let's say we're going to go up to the mesa and we're going to go toss the stone in the middle of Vega Reservoir. What happens when we toss the second stone in the middle of the water? Ripples, right? The ripples go and they go out clear across the pond or clear across the lake. Okay, now we're going to take an even bigger field trip. We're going to take that third stone. We're going to go out in the middle of the ocean. And we're going to toss it in the ocean, or you could toss it in the middle of one of the Great Lakes. What happens? Maybe not quite as noticeable, but there's still going to be ripples, right? That's We Is Greater Than Me. It's your attitudes, your actions, and your behaviors affect not just you, but everyone around you. Think about that for a moment. Your attitude, your action, and your behavior are like ripples that affect not only you, but everybody around you. So, how does that tie into a communion meditation? It's because the night of the Last Supper, when Jesus is telling his disciples, even in the moments, he was staying calm, he was staying collected, and he's like, when you take this bread and when you take this wine, do it in remembrance of me. And then on the cross, what was Jesus doing? He was thinking about the thieves that were on either side of him. He was continually making positive waves, positive ripples. He was putting others before him. And so when Jesus died on the cross, that was the ultimate moment of we is greater than me. And so today, as you take this bread and as you take this juice, remember how Jesus was making those positive ripples. And as you move forward and you leave the service today, I'm going to challenge you. I'm going to challenge you to say, we is greater than me. And I'm going to challenge you to go forth and make positive ripples. Think about a time you've seen a child that has a gift to give away. In particular, a gift to a parent. What's the demeanor of that kid? They're excited. They can't contain themselves. It's almost like they're effervescing joy and excitement through their very pores. And so, as we think about this time of offering, that's how we should be. We should be giving with childlike abandon, because God has given us, God has provided everything that we could possibly need. And so, for that child that has the gift to give their parent, that parent most likely provided the money for the kid to purchase that gift. And so this is our chance to give back. This is our chance to give with childlike abandon. This is our chance to effervesce our joy and our thanksgiving, giving for what God has provided for us. And so let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for the gifts that you provide. And we thank you for giving us what we need. Lord, as we make these offerings back to you, Lord, as we're giving these gifts back to you, Lord, my prayer is that we do this with childlike abandon back to our Father. Lord, use these gifts for the kingdom. And Lord, I ask that you bless those that are giving to you today. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you so much for joining us today. We're so glad you could be here. And as we've come together and communed together and given him thanks, we are called to live with him and make him our number one. And sometimes that's hard. The world is very distracting. But remember, if we submit ourselves to him, if we love him, if we read his word and we know him, then when we turn to God, the Satan has to flee. Resist the devil and submit ourselves to God. And then we truly can live our faith. And those we love and those we know can see him in us. I pray that you do that this week. Let people see Jesus in you.